Good evening and welcome to the Prince George's County Memorial Library System's virtual programs. My name is Nick. I'm the COO for Communication Outreach here at the library. We are broadcasting to you live from Prince George's County, Maryland, which is in the suburbs of Washington, D.C. We are a thriving, amazing community that is the second largest county in Maryland, and we have an amazing community of folks, a very large area. Our library serves 19 branches and has a huge online presence, especially since the COVID pandemic began. We are so grateful for you spending some time with us tonight. We have a very special guest who will be introduced momentarily. Her name is Adrienne Bankert, and we're very, very, very excited to have her here tonight. I had the privilege of hearing her speak before her book came out back in February at the Public Library Association conference in Nashville, right before the world kind of went haywire. And her message has been resonating with all of us here at the library. And we're very excited that she's been willing to share her message with you tonight. So without further ado, I'm gonna turn things over to Roberta with one tiny plug. Tonight is the last night to register online to vote in the state of Maryland and also in Virginia. So if you would like to register online, please go to our website at pgcms.info and redirect to the election page, and that'll take you over to the state registration page. You can register to vote on site at an early vote center or on election day at a regular voting center, but please note that that might cause delays in your ballot being counted. So if you wish to have your ballot counted in advance of election day, we highly encourage you to register online to vote today, whether you want to request a mail-in ballot or vote in person. So without further ado, I would like to welcome the CEO of the Prince George's County Memorial Library System, Roberta Phillips.
Thank you, Nick. He is a fast talker. our guest, as he said, is Adrienne Bankert. She is a national news correspondent with ABC News. She has won 2 Emmys for her work as an interviewer, reporter, and weekend entertainment anchor on Good Morning America, where I start my day. She's known for versatility and ability to connect while reporting on major headlines. She will tell you that genuine warmth and relatability she exhibits in her interviews comes from the habit of practicing connection and kindness. And her book is Your Hidden Superpower, The Kindness That Makes You Unbeatable at Work and Connects You with Anyone. And Adrienne, thank you for being here with us.
Roberta, I'm so glad to be with you. And hello to Washington, D.C. and all points around Maryland, Virginia. Hello, shout out to everybody watching right now.
Yeah, so, you know, you tell us about your journey in life and what led you to writing this specific book. I mean, it's a very timely topic.
Well, you know, it's interesting because life lends itself to pressure. Right. I mean, there are things that happen to us that we don't expect. 2020 was very representative of that. But even before COVID, there were things in life that were starting to really create this pressure cooker around us. Change, divisiveness, disagreements, social media alone, and the culture that that has created with people kind of dismissing certain facets of humanity for the sake of an argument. And so, but in our own lives, we can become very disgruntled or disappointed because things don't go the way that we think they should have gone. We have regrets. I did a speech, oh gosh, I want to say it was 2016, and I had an audience of between 30-year-olds and 70-year-olds. And I was just asked to be the keynote. And I thought, well, what do 30-year-olds have in common with 70-year-olds? And the word regret came to my mind. Everyone. I meet 16-year-olds now who have regret. And I think that we're just in a time where time is speeding up really, really fast. And there are more demands on us to achieve. And this present generation, the young generation, would like to change the world, would like to impact the planet in ways that perhaps previous generations did not, or that they perceive that they did not. And so with all of that in mind, I thought, how can I write a book that answers so many of our questions, no matter how old we are, no matter what our industry is, no matter what place we are in life? How can I answer the question of who are we really? How do we connect and engage in a way that life feels like life? And how do we overcome those disappointments and hurts and the unfairness that life brings? And a light bulb came in over my head. It was actually my mentor who suggested I write a book about kindness. And initially, even I was skeptical. I thought, there's lots of books on kindness. Why would I write a book on kindness? But I realized that it was the one thing that actually roots us in our best self. Because when we are kind, we really are our highest version of our true self. And knowing who we are, it really is a book about identity. Knowing who we are will lend to more genuine connection, more fulfillment, and ultimately that impact that we all want to make in life.
Absolutely. And I'm always telling my staff that, you know, the way for us to connect is to build relationships. Mm-hmm. And that's through trust and through kindness and through, as you said, just humanity, right? Mm-hmm. You know, being human and celebrating not only our differences, but our similarities, right?
Similarities, because we all want someone to be kind to us. I mean, yes. I say in the first chapter, we're all asking for something. You know, some people are asking for a break. Some people are asking for, you know, oh God, I wish somebody would like give me $1 million and send me on a vacation to the Caribbean. You know, I mean, inside of our head, we're wishing that someone larger than us or more, you know, powerful than us would wave a magic wand. Or some of us are just looking for a friend. Mm-hmm. And that can feel larger than life, where we don't know who our tribe is. We just don't know where we belong or where we fit. Or perhaps we've had broken relationships. And like you mentioned, trust. How do we build trust in ourselves when we've trusted the wrong people? Mm-hmm. And again, I think it all goes back to knowing who you are. And I was interviewing Harrison Ford, and I'd asked him some questions, and lots ends up on the cutting room floor when you do an interview with a celebrity. You know, you've got to fit into that 2-3 minute time
right.
ends on live TV. But one of the questions I asked him was about a crisis of identity. And he actually said it was a crisis of conscience. But I would say that people have become numb, where the pain of life or the disappointments of life have become so intense that they turn numb to just cope or survive. And this happens in the youngest of us. This isn't just something of a midlife crisis or something
right.
that happens when you've lived a long life and you look back and wish you could change everything. People everywhere are searching for meaning. And I believe that kindness allows us to develop the emotional quotient to trust again, to heal, and to actually establish the life we always wanted to architect but didn't know how to.
Mm. That's really deep. I think, you know, that whole idea too of listening to people. I think you mentioned in your book that, you know, speak less, listen more, because otherwise you don't know everyone's story. And so can you share what you mean by the story of warm impulses and spontaneity yeah. to be kind to others? I mean, I was brought up that way. I'm one of 8 children, and my mother always taught us to be kind to one another. So, you know, I'll pick something up for somebody who dropped something. You have some of those similar stories. So can you just expand on that?
Yeah, absolutely. I'm one of 7 kids, so we are very similar in that way. Mm-hmm. You don't meet a lot of people who are 1 of 8.
Right, right.
So I'd like to hear your story. But
yes.
I think that I didn't put the dots together until I actually sat down to write this book, because you know how your grandma teaches you how to make cake? Mm-hmm. She doesn't like sit there and point to the recipe. She tells you first you add in the sugar and you mix mm-hmm. it with the butter and you listen to her, and she kind of tells you the recipe anecdotally. And then it ends up with this beautiful cake, but she's been there with you all the time to kind of guide you in this process, right? Mm-hmm. And so I think that with kindness, you end up building a recipe that's been a timeless story that previous generations taught their children and their grandchildren, but this generation has somehow let go of. So, and I don't mean that no one teaches kindness anymore, there are no kind people. I mean, inherently, it's part of the human condition to teach children, to teach others how to treat each other. But somewhere along the way, we've kind of thought we should all know better. So my hope with this book is that we would kind of return to that recipe of our grandmothers and our great grandmothers and our great grandfathers of moving on warm impulses. You mentioned that term I used in the book. There's something programmed, I believe, in each and every one of us where we just have this heart moment of call someone. You know, someone crosses your mind. Right now, if anybody crosses my mind, I usually send them a text where I give them a call, because I'm thinking that's my internal radar for prompting me to notice them, even if they're long distance. Doing that can lead to a conversation that leads to a domino effect of answers, kindness, breakthrough, encouragement for that person and for myself. I think that when you are with someone, a stranger, and you decide to open the door for somebody, I think that take all of the discussion of whether you should open the door for men or women or who aside, it's an impulse that people have as a way to show kindness that perhaps they were raised with, or perhaps they just saw their other family members do it. Mm-hmm. And that's what they see as kindness. Or you might be in line in the drive-thru now for a lot of people because we're not going into the same stores and cafes as much. And you just feel prompted to buy somebody coffee behind you. I think that those are all wonderful things. But right now, instead of thinking we're so out of touch, I've decided to kind of flip the script for all of us and say, as intentional as you are to work out, as intentional as you are to walk your dog and to make sure you brush your teeth every morning and night and to keep a schedule, that you can actually schedule those kindness and those warm impulse moments in your daily life so that you become more practiced in it, and it will actually return us to our kindest selves, something that possibly got lost along the way through generations.
Yeah, my friends always tell me I'm the queen of sending cards, and I do that. I feel like when I'm thinking of someone, I keep a whole stash of cards in my drawer, and like, you know, this person probably needs a card. They've had a rough time, or I know that there's a lot on their plate. And I like the idea, and you're probably like me, that you talk to everybody and anybody, yeah, like the grocery store, the plane. You know, my husband's like, how did you learn all this information about this person on the plane? You were only on the plane for an hour. I'm like, well, we just had a chat. And so I think it's also about how you might open yourself up to that kindness of giving it and receiving it.
Yeah, I mean, it's remarkable who you can meet when you decide to be kind. And it's not just for those of us who are considered extroverts. Mm-hmm. When you decide to show a kindness, I remember being in an airport and a gentleman let me cut in line to have my drink before his or something. Mm-hmm. And I just said, I needed that today. I told him, I said, I just wanted to tell you, you doing that for me today was a refreshing, and thank you so much. And you could tell he cared that I thanked him. It can be that brief of a moment, but yet stir that human connection. We didn't exchange information. We didn't exchange numbers or emails or anything, but it was just that, you know, that breath. And it was like, thank you. Thank you for giving me a breath of fresh air. I think that happens, and it opens us up to being given the energy that we need to keep going. And then I also think that it can facilitate wonderful connections that would never come up if you were not kind. So I've met people on planes like you do, Roberta, and exchanged information and kept in touch and made friendships or business connections. I've met people when I'm walking through the streets of New York. A story that I didn't include in the book that I meant to include in the book was when I was walking through New York and I heard a baby cry. And I'm like, whose baby is that? It was so loud, I could hear the baby across the street. I thought, this baby is in torment. Like, I'm going to walk across the street and encourage the mom. I walked out of my way to meet this woman. It ended up, she worked for another television network. Mm. And it was just like, what are the chances? We exchanged information and made this wonderful connection that would not have happened if I hadn't stopped. And so a year later, I actually ended up being on a panel that she had coordinated for her company, a very large company. And so I just thought, wow, that would never have happened if I hadn't have been kind and stopped. It wasn't about patting myself on the back. It was just showing me how everything we do matters. We lose sight of the fact that our actions have positive consequences. We think no one's noticing, but people are noticing. People do see the people who help put the bags up or take the bags down on the plane. People do see people who thank each other or stop and help an elderly person across the street. And every child and every adult who sees that is reminded and is given hope that we still are inherently hopeful. Because I think that when we see kind acts, it causes us to think, you know what? Life's not as bad. Life's pretty cool. People are pretty cool.
Yeah, and I think that domino effect happens because if you are the recipient of that kindness, you're like, wow, this is an opportunity for me to do something for someone else. I mean, it really does start to cause this lovely chain reaction, I think, which, right now we need so much. I think, we're facing so many challenges right now, multiple crises, the community, from systemic violence against Black Americans to the pandemic and economic crisis that we know is, coming because so many people have lost jobs. So, how does kindness play a role in moving us through this time? Because this is an especially difficult time. I mean, not to say we've all not suffered in the past, but this is just beyond.
Yeah, it's kind of hitting us on all sides. It's interesting. In the beginning, my heart was breaking for all the lonely people. Because first, it was like all the isolation, and it was just like continued isolation, and not just for COVID. It was just the fear that people have, fear of each other. And then my heart was breaking for all the people who are grieving, whether they lost someone they knew or whether they saw something on television that caused them to grieve for the life of another who had died or was killed. And so you're like, okay, how much more emotional taxation can we take? And then the financial pressure, the grieving over losing jobs, losing careers, losing dreams. I mean, you come to the Big Apple for a dream, and now New York doesn't look like New York anymore. It doesn't feel like it. The air doesn't feel like New York. So what do you tell people who've lost all sense of vision, who've maybe lost purpose, who might have lost money, and then also lost hope in humanity? Well, for me, what kindness has done, and I've seen it in my life, I see that a personal crisis and a global crisis need to be approached in the same way. We need people who can think. We need people who can solve problems. And if you are in a state of grief, it's not to say that you can't come out of it. If you are in a state of depression, you can come out of it, but sometimes the only way to come out of it is to give your way out. So who can you serve? And I tell people in the book, the first thing that I would do, and the first thing that I did do, is think, who is my heart breaking for? And what can I do? What steps can I take to lend compassion to a person like that or to a group like that? And I think that companies and corporations need to be more compassionate. And I think several of them have been. And I'm sure there's countless organizations that have really restructured or at least reorganized their thought processes around addressing some of these issues, whether of economic or social justice or any number of things, as you mentioned, the crises. But we need people who can say, I'm going to be one of the problem solvers. I'm going to be one of the game changers. It is something where many of us went through a time of feeling very low. But we have to decide, I'm getting back up again. I'm not letting this crisis stop me. I'm going to be one of those who helps to make this world what it always needed to be in the first place. And when you're generating an energy with kindness, you can do that. It actually keeps you from staying, it keeps you sane, it keeps you in a place of clear-headed thinking. That's why I think kindness fits in this narrative.
Yeah, I think you're right. And our library, PGCMLS, is doing the exact thing you're talking about. How can we pivot? How can we move from a transactional organization to one of social impact? And what do we need to do in order to do that? And so, as I said, kindness is one of our values. That's like the core. We welcome people and then we're kind. And then we're also curious and accessible and many other things. But it starts at that core of really just being kind. One of the things you talk about is your commitment to mentorship. And it sounds like from reading your book that you have had mentors make a big difference in your life. And I think that's another part of kindness. I think there's a lot of people who need someone to look up to guide them, to help them. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Yes, I mean, I think mentoring is one of the kindest things you can do. And a lot of times people don't know how to find a mentor. I always say, don't let the first conversation you have with someone be, will you mentor me? In every instance of life, it's a getting to know you. It's a organic connection where you can actually stimulate conversation and ask good questions and show that you're a good student and show that you're eager to learn and be teachable. And for me, my first mentor actually came when I was in high school. It was my hairdresser who I ended up working for. And I was just so inspired by her life. She's a woman who had a family, married, and had her own business and was striving to just break her generational cycles. And it was just so exciting to see her move through her own spaces in her own shoes. And so I think that for me, just seeing a picture of people who look like us is one facet of mentorship, but not to be so set on a mentor who looks exactly like you. You know, my current mentor who I've had for over a decade is the polar opposite of what I look like in terms of age, in terms of experience, in terms of gender, and yet has been so instrumental in helping me rethink, helping me to inspire people and provoke to new thought, helping me to break my own confines of what it means to be a journalist or what it means to be a storyteller. And I think that in life, we all need a tour guide. We all need someone who's lived a little bit more life than us to guide us, because life is this big adventure. I always say it's like if you went to Nepal, you'd need a Sherpa. And in life, you need a mentor, just like that.
Yeah, that's great. So how do you make time in your hectic schedule to be kind to yourself? And, you know, a lot of us are juggling so many different things, especially, and I'm not one of them, these folks who have young children at home and they're basically helping them through this online virtual platform. There's people taking care of parents or people taking care of loved ones who have COVID. And so, you know, how do you make sure that that's also a routine?
I think that you can't give unless you take care of yourself. Really, if you don't have anything else left to give, you're going to tap out. I call self-care community care. If you don't take care of yourself, you're going to take it out on others, and it won't have really anything to do with them. It's just you'll reach the end of your rope. And so for me, it's about having a routine. A lot of moms, my mom is, again, one of nine who have seven children. And so we have a big family. And I remember seeing her wake up at 4 a.m. so that she could get her workout in. And so for me, having a morning routine is really important before the sun comes up, before the emails start blasting through your inbox. Taking even 15 minutes to breathe, just deep meditative breathing where you can focus on just being still and being clear. I think that journaling is a big part of self-care. I think that a lot of people stop dreaming at a certain point. They say that they still have a goal, but really they're just going through the motions. And I think that the same kind of dreaming and imagination that a child has at age 11 or 16 needs to be applied and practiced, whether you're 36 or 56. And so sit down, take some time to think about your perfect world scenario, as I call it, where things would happen that you just wish would happen. And think about ways that you could either connect with those you know or be bold enough to reach out to those you don't know. A lot of what I've accomplished in life is because I wasn't afraid to make a phone call. And even if I was a little nervous, I didn't let the butterflies deter me from actually reaching out to someone who I thought could maybe help me reach a dream or destination. So taking that quiet time is important to kind of build your own confidence and build your own dream so large that it lifts you beyond apprehension and hesitation.
Yeah, and I agree. I think it's important to have that quiet time, and it's difficult to quiet your mind during this time. So, you know, meditation, which we offer at the library, and yoga for me is my go-to. But any way you want to just be with yourself, right?
Yep. And singing, for some people, singing a song gets you to quiet your mind. I had a song, a theme song for last year and this year, like just singing that song, because a song is easy to memorize. So for people who are really not big into meditation or yoga, one way to meditate is just to regurgitate the same thought over and over again. And songs are a really easy way to do that. So I tell people, I'm like, you might not be a big affirmation person, but maybe there's a song with verses in it that you really buy into that help you feel confident or help you to feel fearless. And so singing that song every day is kind of a part of your morning routine, is one way that you can be kind to yourself and stir that passion that you might need, that heart fire that you need to face the day.
Now I need my own anthem. You know, I always liked Alicia Keys, This Girl's on Fire. So maybe I'll just start singing that one.
There you go. Get an anthem. Yes.
Yeah. So you talk about giving books to folks as a kind gesture in lieu of flowers or other things. And of course, you know, librarians love that. We all want people to read more and be lost in the story.
Oh, say that again. Say that last part.
So tell us why you always give books to folks as gifts and instead of flowers or other things.
You're talking about for grieving. Yes.
For grieving.
So,
okay.
Well, I don't give books all the time, but for specifically that question, because that's why I was like, let me follow you. Let me make
sure. Yeah. Okay.
So in one of the chapters, I talk about how to be kind to those who are grieving. And for me, a lot of times people don't know how to process their feelings. I mean, I myself have dealt with quite a bit of grief. And, you know, getting a card is lovely and getting flowers are lovely. I love fresh flowers. But sometimes I need help processing my emotions. Reading someone else's journey or reading someone else's words or letters helps me to kind of position myself and to let me know that I'm not alone in my grief. And I've just found that giving a book gives people an opportunity to kind of help them to narrate their own story. Because you can grow silent and again in shock, and you don't have the words to express how you feel, but seeing someone else's words helps you to articulate it, even if it's just in your own mind, so you can process out of that and step out of that mourning.
Yeah, that's a great idea. I'm going to have to remember that one, because it is often difficult to find the right words to comfort somebody.
And really, instead of thinking that you have to say the right things, giving them a book allows you to speak without a word. You know, it shows that you care. It gives them a way to process it. And it also allows them to reach back out to you at their ready time. So maybe at the moment, they still are not really feeling like talking about it because they don't want to break down every time they talk. But knowing that you reached out to them first opens a door so that when they're ready, they have someone to come to for a safe place.
So you talk about telling your story, and you also did your own audiobook. Can you tell us a little bit about the experience of recording that? I imagine it's quite different.
Yeah. And, you know, I told my publisher, oh, this is a piece of cake. You know, I've been recording my voice for a living forever. But it's not the same when you're reading your own book, which is a lot more vulnerable than telling someone else's story. So even though this book is not autobiographical, it is a big part of my life. I mean, it's an open book into some of the ways that I think and feel and some of the hardships I've overcome. And there were times in the recording of the audiobook, which I had to do all at home because the studios opened during the pandemic when I recorded it. In fact, it was the height of the pandemic when I decided to record it. And it was very interesting trying to make it sound like a professional booth in here.
Right.
But I actually, my desire was to make my voice so relatable that it sounded like I was talking directly to the person listening to the audiobook. I didn't want it to sound like me talking at you. I wanted it to feel like this is a conversation that I'm having with one person. And it's something that served me well in broadcasting so that when I'm looking into the TV screen or the camera rather, and you see me on the TV screen, I want it to be about the one person who's at home in their living room or in their kitchen or in their bedroom. I'm talking to one person so that even though there are millions of people watching, that one feels connected to. And so in recording the audiobook, that's my tip to anybody who has to record an audiobook, is that you don't want to think about all of the people listening. You want to think about that one person listening while they're riding their bike or while they're taking a jog or while they're walking their dog or while they're washing dishes in the kitchen. And it really helped to actually talk to friends and actually have them listen to me read. That helped me to get into the right space because you tend to like amplify when you're talking into a microphone.
Right. Sure. Yeah. Sure.
To broadcast speak. And I didn't want to do that. I wanted it to be like, I'm telling you a story and you're sitting right next to me. And I'm so glad that that was achieved.
Yeah. In fact, Nick said, you have to listen to the audio book. It's so good in her words. And so now I'm going to go back and listen to it in audio, and which is good for me because I'm definitely not an auditory learner. So I think it'd be a good experience for me. Yeah, I'm a visual person, very much so.
Well, and I included stories in the audiobook that I don't have in the actual book because I ad-libbed. So at the start of every chapter, I'm like, okay, so here's what inspired this chapter. And I just kind of talk off the cuff.
Nice.
Go. I mean, in one take, there's no editing and it's just like, boom. So you'll get a little bit more out of the audiobook that you wouldn't get out of the print. Not that you shouldn't have both. You can have both.
You can have both, and we can offer both. So What do you do if your act of kindness isn't acknowledged or received well?
Oh, well, first of all, you have to not get your feelings hurt, but that's going to happen. Mm-hmm. There's going to be times when, you know, I was just talking to somebody and we had a really candid conversation because it's somebody that I know pretty well. And they were experiencing some resentment and I was experiencing some resentment at not being recognized as the person who was being kind and feeling like it wasn't respected or received. And the fact is that that will happen, but we have to all grow up and mature and realize that no matter how somebody treats us or receives our kindness, who we are, it's who we are. Are you going to let every person that doesn't receive your kindness define who you are? Are you going to let someone else's emotion or response cause you to change into something you don't like, which is bitter or petty or hypersensitive? I mean, I think it's great to accept that you are somebody who has emotions that are still changing and morphing and maturing. The fact is, there will be times when you start to get a little more sensitive and feel like maybe it's not worth it to be as kind. There will be those journeys. I didn't write the book because I'm the kindest person in the world, I tell people. I wrote it because I want to be. And mm-hmm. So the humanity of it all is that being kind and then having somebody not exactly appreciate or acknowledge your kindness actually helps you mature and be more aware of some things that you need to strengthen in your life. Because if they do respond in a way that's not necessarily positive, then you find out what's not necessarily, I don't want to say flawed, but needs to grow up in you. Because no matter how anybody treats me, when I'm on live TV, if somebody starts speaking or cussing or doing something distracting behind the scenes, my job is to actually stay steady. My job is to stay calm. If the whole script goes out of the teleprompter and it just goes really, really fast, go away, it doesn't do me any good to panic or to have a tantrum or to blow somebody or point fingers. I'm not paid to do that. I'm supposed to stay steady. And so really being in journalism, being in broadcasting and live television moments when things did go off the rails helped me use that as an analogy in real life. Because if I can do it for 2 minutes or half an hour on live television and keep my head in the game, then I knew I could and I should grow to the point where I can keep my head in the game no matter what's going on around me, no matter how many people are treating me or mistreating me a certain kind of way. I can keep my self-respect, I can stay steady, and I can be the one who keeps their head in the game. And there's a phone call.
There's a phone call. Sorry, I thought I had my phone off. I think one of the things that's really important that I try to impart on my staff is that you don't ever know what somebody else has gone through.
Right.
So perhaps that act of what you think is kindness is abrupt to them or startles them or is not the right time for them. Mm-hmm. It doesn't mean that they are a terrible person. It just means that, you know, for that particular moment, they didn't receive it. But that same person might 2 days later receive kindness and say, oh my gosh, thank you so much. So it's really about being human, right?
And empathetic and knowing that, you know, you don't know what's going on behind the scenes. A lot of times, in the work that I do, you have such brief interactions with people. We don't see each other in the hallways anymore, at least not right now, in the studio the way that we used to. But in those brief interactions, it's really easy to misjudge a person and to think they're aloof or standoffish. Just recently, something happened where I knew something wasn't right with one of my colleagues and I couldn't quite put my finger on it. And I endeavored to be really friendly, like, oh, hey, how are you? Are you good? Hoping that they would like let on that something was up, but they didn't. So I didn't press. But I walked away thinking, man, something was different. And they messaged me privately later and said, hey, sorry if I seemed off. Something had just happened. And they told me what had happened. And I thought, oh my goodness, like, that explains it. I knew it was something. I just couldn't put my finger on it. Well, if I wasn't in tune or empathetic or compassionate, I could have thought that that person was being difficult or being rude or being standoffish or anything. But I wasn't judging the situation because I didn't know. I just knew something wasn't quite right. And we live in a time, again, with so much pressure, with all the different crises going around, personal and global, that people aren't even necessarily aware of how much they are responding to those crises. Really, what the pandemic has taught me is that we don't know what's inside of us. We don't really know how we tick when everything comes up at us. You know, when all of this stuff hits the fan, we've learned now kind of some of the stuff that's inside of us that responds to enormous pressure. And so we have to give each other a lot more grace than we might have even had to give 5-10 years ago.
Mm-hmm. So how do you know, one of the things, one of the recommendations I hear, and you can't do it because of your job, is to limit the amount of news you watch.
Well, I say if you're going to watch the news, then the other thing you have to do is you have to spend the same amount of time, which most people can't do. So they have to limit, they'd have mm-hmm. to like make a decision. If you're going to watch 2 hours of news, let's just say, mm-hmm. let's just make it manageable. If you're going to watch 30 minutes of news, then you need to watch 30 minutes of kindness videos on YouTube. Just search kindness or good humans and look up, or go to, you know, my YouTube channel and just look up anything you can to renew and restore your hope in humanity. Because there's a lot going on.
And that's why I like the last few minutes of the newscast, you know, because it's like, and now our, you know, superhuman of the week. And it's like, okay, so sometimes my husband will joke with me, he goes, are you going to watch the last 5 minutes of the news? I'm like, yeah, they're going to tell a positive story. And I need newscasters for doing those positive stories. Yeah. In the book, you discuss the importance of being the same person in private and professional and public settings. Can you discuss why this is so important?
Oh my gosh. Well, because, you know, it's so funny. When I was younger and I'd watch the news, I wanted to be like the great journalists, you know, that we all know from of old. And yet I just sometimes would watch certain broadcasters and I'd think, you know, I wonder if they're really like that. I wonder if they're that nice in person. You know, I wonder if they're that nice when the camera goes off. And I was a 12-year-old, 13-year-old girl when I was considering whether this was a performance or whether it was who they really were. And so I made this like resolution in myself as a teenager that I would be the same person in private as I am in public. And my mom as a kid would say, Adrienne, somebody's always watching you. And those words just stuck with me, kind of put the fear of don't do anything you don't want to get caught doing. Mm-hmm. In private, in public. And so my, you know, it's a practice. It's something that I was very deliberate about. But I think that most people act differently when they think somebody is watching them, when they're an eye on you. You post social media differently when you realize that somebody you know, or somebody who could hire you, or somebody who could date you, maybe you're interested in that, is watching you. You post different tweets and Instagram and TikToks. And so I just think that it's something that a lot of people used to call reputation. Mm-hmm. I think that's still around. It's just, we don't call it reputation. We tell people we're going to look at your social media account. We tell people that we're going to look at your, you know, your, I don't know, your past usage of words and how you treat people in a public sphere, but it's very private when we are posting at the same time. So those lines kind of are being blurred. But if you are as kind when no one's watching as you are when someone's watching, then you'll always be the best you. And being the best you is all we're asking for. Being the real you is all we're asking for. And it takes a lot less energy to think about, oh, somebody's watching, so let me put on my happy face. Let me put on my responsible face. Let me put on my professional face. And then, oh, let me all hang it out, you know, and like, say whatever I feel like and talk about my boss and talk about my coworkers. Mm-hmm. Thinking it's like, no, talk like there's a camera on you 24/7, because there almost always is.
Yeah, that's great advice. And I think it's, you know, like you said, the pressures of social media, especially for young people, you know, have made it very difficult for them to, you know, not get bullied or not be who they really are, because they want this kind of facade. But I think if people do exactly what you said and then treat everything with kindness, then like there's nowhere else to go but up, right?
Yeah, and if you have a stressful situation happen, or if you have something happen where you feel like venting, talk to a friend or a trusted advisor or a mentor first. Don't go to a public setting to air your frustration. And if you do want to tweet something, I have a lot of friends who will run it by their spouse first. Mm. But what I talk about in the book is let somebody veto your decision to post. Because if you do it in the heat of a moment, or if you do it in anger and passion, then you might regret it. You know, unfortunately, there's no proof that just because you deleted it means that somebody didn't snap it. You know, somebody didn't take a picture or a screenshot. And I just think that life is too short and the stakes are too high for any of us to think that we are immune to the court of public opinion. It's not about people pleasing. It's about putting our best face forward, and it's about preparing for the future. And quite frankly, you know, why not avoid controversy in your younger years? Why not avoid having a problem where an employer has to ask you, you know, well, what did you mean by this tweet? Or what did you mean when you posted this on YouTube? And instead, just talk to someone who cares about you, who can honestly be a sounding board. And that way you save yourself a lot of grief in the future. I just think it would be a less complicated life. It'd be more fun.
Absolutely. Yeah. I recently had a friend who referred to me as the queen of kindness. And I said, I will take that all day. I said, that's a great, you know, because we were talking, it was a leadership meeting, and we were talking about, you know, helping our staffs and our customers and our community through this difficult time. And I just said, this was before I even knew I was going to interview you. I just said, well, you have to start by being kind to everybody, because that's what we need right now, is more kindness. So I'm going to see if anyone else has questions for you about kindness and your book. So I'm going to ask Nick if there's any questions in the queue that he would like to share with us.
If you want, while he's doing that, I can read something if you want.
Lovely. Yes, that'd be great.
So while Nick is seeing if there's any questions, I'm going to read page 21 of the book. And this is The Power to Be You. And every one of us has a value system, and there are many times in our life where there is a crossroads. If we are not careful, we'll be in denial of aspects of our lives that need to change, mainly because we are not used to living by our conscience. The sound of our own desires spoken by our voice can become muted because we start to make choices based on the bills we need to pay, what we feel we can control, or what we think is demanded of us. For example, you might know someone who enjoys their career but dreads weekends when they punish themselves by hanging out with people they've outgrown and don't even like. When you're lonely, you may overcompensate by working too much, eating too much, or use other vices in attempts to fill the void. You may have friends who have a huge salary and a beautiful home but are unhappy, yet they refuse to change because they are too comfortable. How do you avoid compromising your own standards? Embrace kindness. It will help you pay attention to your conscience for others' benefit. You will become an expert in trusting your gut. Instead of being motivated by loneliness, obligation, or any number of preferences, kindness removes judgment. By developing an inclination to do what is right without overanalyzing all the facts and stats about the person you're helping, you will become more practiced in sensing intuitively what is right for your own life and develop the courage to make changes with the proper motivation. You'll know what is right right now. And I remember writing that and thinking that so many times we get driven. We're driven by ambition. We're driven by the need to please people. We're driven by the need to feel accepted. We're driven by our loneliness or by our emptiness or our void. And I knew that for me, I never wanted to live like that. And if I ever slipped to that, I wanted to know how to get out. And kindness for me was a way to be authentic and to serve others and to really impact the world. So
this question just came in, and you need to call your publisher. Have you considered sharing the kindness message with children in a picture book?
Yes, I have. Yeah. Yes, I have. In fact, it's on my list of things to do. And I would love to, because, you know, I think that children, getting this message early on is such a key. I think I wanted to speak to the business community when I wrote this book. I don't think I know, because we as adults spend so many hours at work. So yes, that's my dream. That's coming.
Oh, great. Well, you please let us know when you have it published, and you are welcome back again, because I am a former children's librarian and picture books are my jam. So
oh, that's awesome.
Yeah. Let's see. There just looks like there could be another
question from Ms. Vivian.
Yes, Miss Vivian is our rock star fan. She joins all our conversations, and I think she maybe wants to know what have you done during the virus to keep this kindness going?
Yeah, for me, again, like in the very beginning of the pandemic, I see this from Anna Parker. This reading is everything. I cannot wait to get this book. Thank you, Anna. It's funny because I'm getting like multiple like data here. It's cool. But for Ms. Vivian, COVID really impacted me. I think that people who knew me well and knew I was a people person found out even deeper how I was such a people person and needed people intrinsically to feel alive. And so when we were at a time of safer at home, it was really heart-wrenching for me. And so I pitched a few ideas to Good Morning America. We ran some stories online about mental health, and just creating your own light at the end of the tunnel. One of the suggestions that I got and that I encourage everyone to do is write a letter to your future self on the other side of this pandemic.
Oh, that's great.
Yeah. And just like writing that letter saying, listen, you made it through COVID-19. You made it through to the other side of safer at home and the streets being empty and feeling isolated and alone and mourning the loss of loved ones, but you're still here. And this is what you are doing with your life as a result of living through this tragic time. And I also came up with this idea because I miss seeing people's faces so much that I was like, how can we be kind digitally in a way that a little more creative? And so I was inspired actually by somebody who works with me that she adopted, her and her friends adopted some fellow friends who had been furloughed, providing them groceries and food at a time where they are out of work. And so I thought you could buy coffee for people anywhere using Venmo or Cash App. You can get Uber Eats delivery to almost anyone in most, you know, major cities and suburbs all across the country and just surprise people because I can't take you out to lunch or coffee. Mm. So just a way to be digitally kind from your couch and even just giving people cash and just depositing it into their accounts, Venmo or Cash App, or even if you had their bank account info was like, hey, next coffee's on me, here's 10 bucks. Mm. You know, rather than feel like you have to solve all the world's problems, 5 or 10 bucks could just brighten somebody's day for a moment. And so my approach to kindness became one where I had to get even more creative because I wasn't around the people that I normally was. And then also you can't smile as broadly when you have a mask on your face. Right. So how can I bring a smile to other people when I don't see them? And that was just something else. And then the other thing, the third idea I was going to share is that I started sending people text videos. So instead of the traditional text message, I would record a 10 to 15 second video and text people and say how much they were appreciated, how much I longed to see them and I couldn't wait to see their face and press send. And the smiles on colleagues' faces and the smiles from coworkers and friends was like remarkable. So those are just a few of the ideas that I had during COVID-19.
I love that. This is a great question from our friends that say, how important are libraries for advancing kindness?
Well, I said this before we got on the live event that I was at the Public Library Association, the PLA, right? In Nashville in February, I think is what Nick was saying. And so it was just nice to see librarians celebrated. I don't think that we really understand some of the folks that make the world go round, and having libraries as a service that really unifies people of all walks of life and all different economic and socio levels. And so for us to have messages of kindness and to feature events like these is so crucial because it's one of the ways that we can actually come together at low cost or no cost to the surrounding community. And storytelling is just something that I know will never die. It is part of the human experience. And so we need to allow people, even if they can't afford to go buy a book, or perhaps they're just being very, you know, eco-savvy by recycling the use of books that are already on the shelves. This is a way for us to continue to be kind and to continue to stay in touch with one another.
So here's a great kindness tip I just thought of. Buy this book from our friends at Loyalty and send it to someone.
A great idea.
Yeah. And then, you know, you help our local bookstore and our entrepreneurs, and also you get the word out, because this is really, really strong words, Adrienne. This, you know, conversation with you has really meant a lot to me. And I know our viewers are posting the same thing, that they can't wait to get your book and they enjoy it. Any last words of wisdom?
Well, I just think that for all of us, we need to know who we are. You know, I think I said that towards the beginning of it, but when you think about social media, I've talked about this in different speeches. You know, do you remember Chewbacca mom a few years ago in the car? She put on a Chewbacca mask and she just started laughing hysterically, and it posted on Facebook and it went viral and it went around the world, and she became an icon to some people. For stay-at-home moms who made an impact. And so I think that we live in a time where technology is proving that any one of us can come out of obscurity at any time. Any one of us can have a message that is broadcast all around the world, whether that's on social media, YouTube. And so I think we need to care about ourselves enough to realize the weight of our own words and impact. Mm-hmm. And so just like technology is pointing to the fact that anybody can be an influencer, quote unquote. Anybody can be someone who becomes this instant overnight sensation based on something they said or something they did. That's how we need to treat kindness. We need to make kindness famous, and we need to give ourselves enough worthiness to know that every word, everything we say and do impacts another life, and that will reverberate over time and across communities. And you don't know what your kindness will bring. It could save a life. It could give someone hope. It could open doors of opportunity for yourself or for another person. And so we have to take kindness more heavily and not take it so lightly. Mm. And I'm so grateful that libraries like yours are making sure this message is famous.
Oh, thank you so much. It's been a pure joy to speak with you. And you are welcome back when you get your children's picture book published. We will have you. We thank everyone for joining us. And it was a great discussion tonight. Again, your hidden superpower, you can get it from pgcmls.info or buy it for a friend or yourself from Loyalty Bookstore. If you buy for yourself, you'll be like me. You'll start tagging pages and making comments. And that's good when it's your book. But we thank you so much for joining us. And we hope that you have a great rest of your week.
Roberta, can we answer one more question?
Oh, sure. Certainly.
Nick flagged it too. I think it's time. On YouTube, it said, how to be kind when you yourself need your own encouragement, so your kindness doesn't come off fake. What I think she's asking, and you closed it out so perfectly. I was like, wait, sorry. No, you're perfect. So to be kind to yourself, meaning so that you authentically come from a heart of kindness versus just smiling in people's faces and acting like everything's okay. So the first thing I would do is I would make sure to schedule something you can do in your own city, whether that's a manicure, pedicure, a spa massage, a facial, something that you really love and enjoy doing, because a lot of things are shut down. I know here in New York, it wasn't until September that we could get a facial, but we could get massages in, I think, August. So do something kind for yourself, set aside that time. A lot of times as women specifically, we don't do that. We don't make time for ourselves. Do that and carve it out as something that you schedule, you know, once every 2 weeks, once a week, once a month, whatever it is, so that you never feel ripped off. Because what tends to happen is people are really good givers, but they're terrible receivers a lot of times. They'll give and give and give and give. And secretly inside, they wish that they could have somebody give back, but they don't feel comfortable necessarily receiving that. So get used to being treated well. Make sure that you do things that help you, whether it's, you know, scheduling time to have a girlfriend day, you know, where you guys get together and have a brunch or a coffee or a tea. But don't neglect yourself, because as you refuel, you'll be recharged to be authentically kind, and it will come off in a way that's genuine. So don't dismiss yourself. Give to others, but also receive the kindness that you need for yourself. I hope that helps.
Yeah. And that's a great ending as well. Be kind to yourself, be kind to others.
Absolutely.
And Miss Vivian says amen.
Okay. Thanks, Miss Vivian.
All right. Thanks so much, Adrienne. We really appreciate it.
Roberta, it was so nice to meet with you. Thank you to Nick and thank you to the public library. We love you.
All right. Good night, everyone.
Good night.